Good evening, I'm Jim Lehrer.
On the NewsHour this Wednesday, it was another heavy day of news on the Middle East.
Jim Lehrer always told those of us privileged to work with him, it's not about us. But night after night, Jim showed by example that being yourself, journalist, writer, family man, citizen, can be a high calling indeed. For 36 years as an anchor of the NewsHour, Jim reported the news.
People often ask me if there are guidelines in our practice of what I like to call McNeil-Lehrer journalism. Well, yes, there are.
He did it with a clear sense of purpose, even as the world of media changed around him.
Do nothing I cannot defend. Cover, write, and present every story with the care I would want if the story were about me. Assume there is at least one other side or version to every story. Assume the viewer is as smart and as caring and as good a person as I am. Assume the same about all people on whom I report. Assume personal lives are a private matter until a legitimate turn in the story absolutely mandates otherwise. Carefully separate opinion and analysis from straight news stories and clearly label everything. Do not use anonymous sources or blind quotes except on rare and monumental occasions. No one should ever be allowed to attack another anonymously. And finally, I am not in the entertainment business.
Jim Lehrer was born in 1934 in Wichita, Kansas, the son of Lois, a bank clerk, and Harry, a bus station manager. He attended Victoria College in Texas and then studied journalism at the University of Missouri. His father and brother before him enlisted in the Marines, and Jim served 3 years as an infantry officer in the late 50s, including time in the Pacific. He saw no combat, but spoke often of how the experience shaped him, including at a 2010 parade the Corps put on in his honor.
Seldom a day goes by that I don't know that I am doing something because of something I learned in the Marine Corps. And I only have one favor to ask of all of you here tonight, particularly all of you Marines. Forget all that civilian stuff for the next hour or two, and do your best to think of me only not as an old man in a dark blue suit with a red tie, but think of me as Lehrer, James C., First Lieutenant, USMC, serial number 071278, MOS 0302 Infantry, Executive Officer, Bravo Company, 1st Battalion, 9th Marines, 3rd Marine Division. Thank you, and Semper Fidelis.
In 1960, Jim married his lifelong partner and love, Kate Staples. He also began his journalism career in earnest, joining the Dallas Morning News and then the Dallas Times-Herald, reporting on local politics and serving as city editor. He covered his first history-making story, the assassination of John F. Kennedy in Dallas in 1963. Jim and Robert McNeil, who covered the assassination for NBC News, spoke of it on the NewsHour in 2014.
And it was just, it was disbelief. What I took away and have taken away, and it still overrides everything that I have done in journalism since. What the Kennedy assassination did for me was forever keep me aware of the fragility of everything. That at any given moment, something could happen. I mean, my God, if they could shoot the president. And when I later became city editor of that same newspaper, I had a rule that every phone that rang in that newsroom got answered, because you never knew who was on the other line.
Either one of you school board members want to comment on that recommendation?
Jim's television career was also launched in Dallas at public station KERA.
I'm Jim Lehrer, and this is Newsroom, a program of local news, analysis, and opinion.
But Irvin and Baker aren't the only...
His move to the national stage with PBS came as a correspondent for what was then called the National Public Affairs Center for Television, or NPACT. It was there he first joined McNeil to cover another watershed moment.
From Washington, NPAC brings you gavel-to-gavel videotape coverage of today's hearings by the Senate.
In 1973, the new McNeil-Lehrer team broadcast the Senate Watergate hearings live and then presented a rebroadcast with analysis late into the night, some 250 hours in all.
So unless those tapes are made public or some other revelation comes our way, the senators, as well as the rest of us who are interested, may have to eventually make an ultimate choice between believing John Dean or Bob Haldeman. That's the way it looks to me, at least, at 3 or so in the morning. Feel free to disagree.
Jim and Robin talked with me about it on the 40th anniversary.
Remember, we broadcast it live during the daytime as it happened, and then we completely repeated it gavel to gavel, so it was a double hit there, and that was a huge commitment for public broadcasting to make, and the reason they made it was because this premise that the presidency of the United States was at stake.
Some 70,000 letters poured in praising the team and its work. Jim, in his own words, picks up the story of what happened next.
We began life in October 1975 as the Robert McNeil Report.
Good evening. New York's Governor Hugh Carey said today,
and months later became the McNeil-Lehrer Report.
Jim?
Robin, there used to be just two basic ways to buy a house.
Right? In those days, we dealt with one story for half an hour.
Expanded from the present half hour to a comprehensive one-hour program of news.
That transition to the McNeil-Lehrer News Hour happened in 1983.
Good evening. Yes, said the Soviet Union, we shot down that Korean airliner, but we didn't know it was a civilian plane, and it was completely justified.
12 years later, Robin McNeil retired, and we became the News Hour with Jim Lehrer.
Over the years, Jim interviewed numerous leading figures on the world stage, including Margaret Thatcher and Yasser Arafat in the 1980s, South Korean President Kim Dae-jung and Chinese leader Jiang Zemin in the 90s, Jordan's King Abdullah and Afghan President Hamid Karzai in the 2000s.
On the News Hour tonight, the global financial storm.
He daily examined major turning points in the nation's life.
Where did the money originally?
He pressed experts from the business world.
Just simply a propaganda move.
Then military brass.
Recent opinion polls rank the tomato among the least loved of all vegetables. Other
people. On occasion, he turned to the unconventional to explain issues. You've heard it. Most notably, of course, he interviewed American political figures.
The news of this day is that Kenneth Starr, the independent counsel, is investigating allegations that you suborned perjury by encouraging a 24-year-old woman, former White House intern, to lie under oath in a civil deposition about her having had an affair with you. Mr. President, is that true?
That is not true. That is not true. I did not ask anyone to tell anything other than the truth. There is no improper relationship, and I intend to cooperate with this inquiry. But that is not true.
Another day of infamy for the United States of America.
He was calm and careful in moments of crisis.
President Bush issued an ultimatum to President Saddam Hussein of Iraq tonight. Leave power and your country in 48 hours or face military action.
Robin McNeil said this of his longtime friend and partner.
Jim's intelligence is so laser-like, no matter what he's applying it to.
A snowflake.
In interviewing, I learned a lot from him, because I'd sort of come out of the school of an interviewer carrying on like the Secretary of State in waiting. Well, Mr. Secretary, we all know that the situation with the Russians in Lower Moldavia has been intolerable for a long time, and that U.S. policy has been, ever since Senate Resolution 304, that we should do la la la, so what are you going to do about it, or something like that. And Jim always cuts through all that crap and says, what are you going to do about this? Or what does this mean? Or I don't understand, explain to me. And I learned a lot from his manner of very direct interview, and not being afraid to say you don't understand or you don't know.
Perhaps nowhere was this seen better than on the largest stage of all, with upwards of 60 million viewers. As moderator of 12 presidential debates, more than any other person in U.S. history. His first in 1988, his last 2012. And in 1996 and 2000, he moderated all the presidential debates, the first to do that.
What are you going to have to give up in terms of the priorities that you would bring as president of the United States?
For Americans, Jim would say, the debates are the one chance to take the measure of candidates side by side. And the stakes are incredibly high.
None of us has any idea what Jim Lehrer intends to ask.
One person who usually did know what Lehrer would ask was his wife, Kate, who served as his main debate preparation sounding board. In 2012, she shared what that was like.
As soon as this process really gets underway, it's sliding in the, I'm Alice in Wonderland going in the rabbit hole. Praying to come out on the other side.
It's safe to say this is pretty nerve-wracking.
It's very nerve-wracking. It's just fairly surreal.
Debate in 2004.
The occasion for our talk was Jim's book, Tension City, a reflection on his role in presidential debates. What he called walking down the blade of a knife.
It's not a lot of fun, but if you get to the other end, it's really exciting.
You've made it.
You've made it.
Thank you, Senators, both.
When the debate is over that I moderate, I want everybody to say, okay, here you have seen and heard the candidates for President of the United States on the same stage at the same time talking about the same things, and you can judge them. I mean, do you like this guy? Is this person really, you know, is he telling the truth? All that kind of stuff. Well, you can't, and you see them right there together. It's a huge test. Cast iron toys. So my collecting is kind of a mix.
But it wasn't all tension and worldly affairs. One great passion on display in his basement at home and his office at work, the intercity bus memorabilia Jim collected over the years. A reminder of his father's career and his own early Kansas childhood.
As my brother says, we kind of have diesel smoke in us.
Over the years, Jim would delight many a crowd with his bus call.
May I have your attention, please? This is your last call. For Continental Trailways, 8:10 p.m., Silversides Air Condition, through liner to Houston.
There was also Jim Lehrer, the prolific writer, author of some 20 novels, drawing on his life as a newsman, his interest in history, politics, and yes, buses. He also wrote plays and three memoirs.
I write a little bit on my fiction every day. It's just what I do. And yes, I have my day job. I do that too, but I do both things every day.
Jim Lehrer.
Jim earned dozens of journalism awards and honorary degrees.
Jim Lehrer is a modern man of letters who has left us a gift of professionalism and civility.
He was given the National Humanities Medal by President Clinton, elected as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and with Robert McNeil, inducted into the Television Hall of Fame. Although he insisted on not being the center of attention when reporting the news, at one important juncture in his life, Jim did tell a deeply personal story of the major heart attack that almost killed him in 1983.
Mr. Lehrer, you just had a heart attack.
The documentary, My Heart, Your Heart, captured how the scare led to a change in diet and lifestyle. Among other things, he would become a committed afternoon napper. There was no disturbing Jim between 1 and 2 o'clock. One priority never changed, his family. Jim and Kate, herself the author of three novels, had three daughters, Jamie, Lucy, and Amanda, and 6 grandchildren. Jim Lehrer stepped down as full-time anchor of the NewsHour in 2011. Late in his tenure, he closed a speech to PBS station managers this way.
We really are the fortunate ones in the current tumultuous world of journalism right now. When we wake up in the morning, we only have to decide what the news is and how we're going to cover it. We never have to decide who we are and why we are there. That is the way it has been for these nearly 35 years, and that's the way it will be forever. And for the NewsHour, there will always be a forever.
I'm Jim Lehrer. Thank you and good night.